Let us try that once again, and thank you for those of you that notified us that we didn't have any sound. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. My name is Jamie, and this morning I have Viam on camera with me. There you go, we've got two thumbs up for the price of one this morning. And we are coming to you live, wait, hold on, I'm gonna just cover the salient points. Coming to you live from Djuma, Arethusa, and Sheet Plains Game Reserve in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. And if you want to get really specific, we're on the boundary between Djuma on my left, and actually technically Simbambili on my right, and then just a little bit further south in front of me is Arethusa on my right. And not only are we live, but we're also interactive, which means send through your questions on hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And what an exciting morning we have planned for you. Well, I say that, one of two things is going to happen. Either we're going to have a very exciting morning planned for you, or I think it's going to rain. Which is also exciting, I suppose, in its own way, because, of course, South Africa is in the grips of a terrible drought, so we're not going to turn our noses up at any sign of rain, but it is suddenly very cold this morning. It was 18 degrees centigrade, which is 65 in Fahrenheit. Look at this, that's quite a nice view. On the misty morning, next to the power lines. Hello, Ellie. This is the equivalent of Thursday morning traffic. I think it's Thursday. Yep. Thursday morning traffic here in the African bush. And as our Ellie strolls along Triple M, hopefully not obscuring the tracks that I'm looking for, as I said, look at it, it might rain. It's certainly threatening to, which would be a surprise to me. I didn't initially think that it was going to rain at all. Either way, we will have something exciting planned for you. No man fly. This is getting ridiculous. Yesterday evening on the Sunset Safari, I had one fly into my mouth mid-sentence, which I find personally quite offensive. I feel as though a certain regard for personal space would be ideal. Right, so we are on the boundary between Djuma and Simbambili, Arethusa, in order to search for tracks of a Tingana and Shadow. So the dominant male leopard of this area, who yesterday we were sitting with at Red Dam, and he was looking particularly full. He looked like he'd had a very solid meal. He was looking really, really good. And then just as we were finishing the Sunset Safari and actually tying in perfectly, just as I had to leave the sighting because there were other vehicles approaching, Shadow, the female leopard, turned up. She was obviously listening to him calling. He'd been calling throughout that sighting in a very, I wouldn't call it lazy way, but certainly relaxed kind of a way. That sawing sound that leopards make. He was doing that yesterday afternoon, and I think that that attracted the attention of Shadow. Very sadly, we couldn't be there for the moment of a reunion between the two of them. I'm not sure how Tingana would have taken it. He always seems a little put upon whenever the ladies happened upon his presence. But I'm thinking that I was going to say he could go one of two ways. He could go one of four ways, essentially. But I think chances are he's going to start moving back towards the east, and that's what I'm hoping to find. Luckily, the tracks of mating leopards tend to be relatively easy to find. And of course, if you can't find their tracks, well, you should certainly be able to hear them from a considerable distance in front of you, just because their mating process is quite aggressive and quite noisy. Now that's the plan for this morning, for now, but as you know, plans always go awry, things change all the time. And for example, we've got the distraction of this lovely Ellie. Ah, there we go. James Richard is on the same page as myself. He has his fingers crossed for mating leopards today. VM, do you have your fingers crossed for mating leopards?
Just leopards in general.
Just leopards in general, fair enough. No specifics, just leopards in general. James, I'm on exactly the same page. I'm sure they are. I really would have loved to have been there for the moment of the meetup. Having watched Tingana flee Shadow's presence before, admittedly, to be fair, he had just been chased by a lion, so I think that's fair enough. I think he just had it in general. Hello, my boy. Hello, big boy. Do you mind if we join you for a bit? Aww. Lovely big boy. This elephant bull is going to be spectacular in the next few years. We've got two elephant bulls. This one closest to us and then the one behind. Their own little bachelor herd. Oh, eat and run. This particular elephant has a serious set of tusks on him, but of course he got shy and put his head behind the tree. Well, there's nothing like the peace and serenity of an elephant sighting. And a very good question coming through from Wyatt, who obviously was observing the sighting that we had earlier as this particular elephant wandered along the road. Now, Wyatt, you wanted to know whether or not elephants will ever push down power lines, which makes complete sense as we watch them devouring the trees. It's a very, very valid question. And the answer is generally not. So they are strong enough to do it. It's not that they are incapable. You usually find that animals tend to leave the power lines alone because, of course, elephants push over trees to get to the leaves. That's why they do it. Or the bark, or whichever aspect of the tree. I'm going to just reposition as we do this to see if we can get a view of the other bull. They're going after some aspect of the tree to eat. The power lines' poles are not edible, and they know this. Elephants are incredibly intelligent creatures. They can also, I think they can feel the electricity buzzing through the power lines. And that to me, oh, mister, you're such a shy Ellie for such a big bull. Personally, I think they can feel or at least hear the hum of the electricity moving through the power lines, which has a tendency to, there you go, he's giving us a nice show of how they knock down trees, which has a tendency to sort of, I don't know, prevent them from messing with the power lines in any way. That being said, occasionally elephants do play around with electricity, and I've known many elephants to go and dig up power lines, I think probably on their way towards the water pipes, but they have been known to cause that level of destruction, and occasionally they also use the power lines as convenient rubbing posts, and that applies to many animals out here, largely the elephants and the rhino. I've seen rhino sharpening their horn against a power line pole. Now it does happen. But for the most part, they're relatively good at avoiding them. And this, of course, is a main road, so most of the roads that we drive don't have power lines at all. But this particular one sends electricity across to all of the lodges. And the pendulum of his tail swishing backwards and forwards. Sniffing gently at the leaves, trying to figure out what's appropriate for breakfast and what isn't. As I said, he's quite a shy elephant. and slowly moving off into dense vegetation, but even with us driving next to him, he didn't seem to be entirely... He's not uncomfortable. He just doesn't want to stick around too close to the vehicle. Which is interesting, because at this age, in general, as a general rule, elephants of this age tend to be quite curious, so they will often approach vehicles just to see what they are, see if they can intimidate us, and so on. But this particular elephant bull, not interested at all. Well, since he's vanished off into Simbambili, I think it's time to head across to Taylor so that she can say a very good morning to you all.
Good morning again. I hope you're all having a wonderful morning or a wonderful sleep, or perhaps you need to go to bed. Now, my name is Taylor, and on camera with me, we've got Brian, and of course, the ever so famous, the Thumb. There he is in his suit and tie. Now, I know Jamie's on a leopard hunt this morning, and I'm a little bit embarrassed to say that the lions have been giving me a run around over the last few days. However, our suspicions were indeed correct, and we knew that they were somewhere along this drainage, down on the right, somewhere in the spot that they quite enjoy. Now, I just am very quickly crawling along this road just to see that I don't miss any tracks. And I just want to back up a little bit here, because I thought I may have seen a whole lot of lion tracks. And I obviously don't want to miss them, so I'm sorry if I'm not going to look over my shoulder, but I just want to concentrate. Yes, I can see the little footprints of the bundles of joy. Here comes Herbie to the rescue, though, as well, because he's looking, so I just want to tell him that there are a few little lion tracks on this little junction that we are. Now, Herbie's obviously an expert at tracking, and he will be able to find the lions probably better than I ever could, which is amazing. So it looks as though he's found something now, which is quite exciting. Just footprints, of course. You can see him. Oops, sorry, I'm driving along. There's Herbie getting out, getting now down and low and one with the track. Now, I don't want to squash too many of his tracks either, just because I want him to be able to see exactly where those lions are going. But we all... Okay, Herbie's given us the signal. He's done. He's sort of like an air hostess this morning. Come this way, so let's go that way. And he's got some tracks. And hopefully he'll be able to give us a better indication of which way they've gone. Now, we haven't seen the Nkuhumas for, I think, like 2 days now. I'm missing them. I'm not sure about all of you back at home watching this. Hi, Herbie. I've seen a few Mantuan tracks going up and down here. Hey? They were lying. Ah, okay. Herbie was pointing down to below the ground. Apparently the lions were actually lying in this vicinity. Let's see if we can perhaps have a look. You see that little smudge mark over there? You can sort of see a slight paw indentation. So this is where they were resting. So perhaps they were right down below in the drainage from where we are and then came up this way. Now, we need to figure out where exactly they've gone from here. It's sort of like a bit of an investigation. Now, like I said, Herbie's the best man. So, Herbie, do you think that they were lying in this drainage yesterday and they came out? Okay. Sneaky, because we were driving all around there looking for them. What do you think they've done? Where would you like me to check next? Okay, let me check. I did also check. I checked pangolin track. I did savages track towards Trias. Nothing. No tracks going that side. So they must still be in this area. Right.
Check this one for me.
Okay, let's go do that. We've got strict instructions from Herbert this morning that we need to go and check Wahlberg's Road and have a little look. See, there were lots and lots of buffalo in the area yesterday, and we saw a variety of herds moving through. So perhaps they've found themselves a tasty morsel. That's what I'm hoping. I didn't think that they needed to go particularly far. And we might even be able to say hello to Mr. and Mrs. Wahlbergs before we check Wahlbergs Road. I can see one of them just perched up and out in the open. Isn't that going to be lovely? I haven't seen the Wahlbergs for ages. Let's have a look. Hello. Just going to try and creep up to it. Here we go. There's Mr. and Mrs. Wahlbergs. Well, I don't know, one of them. Good morning. You look frightfully cold today. Doesn't look very impressed with us. Is he all fluffed up? It even looks like he's still got a bit of bedhead. Now you need to brush your feathers before you wake up, or after you've woken up in the morning. You can't look unpresentable for the show. That's ridiculous. It's quite funny though. It's not very cold either, so it's bizarre as to why this bird has fluffed itself up like that. Perhaps it's just having one of those days. Now, there seem to be quite a few buffalo weavers flying around, and they're watching carefully.
For the show? That's ridiculous. Can't look unpresentable for the show? That's ridiculous.
Keeping just a close eye on everything.
For the show? That's ridiculous. Can't look unpresentable.
You'll see the Wahlberg's eagle just every now and then looking around. Those buffalo weavers seem to be getting a little bit close every now and then, and not too impressed with that. Now, I know some of you are wondering if we got any rain last night. Now, unfortunately, we didn't get any rain. We absolutely wish that we did get some rain, but unfortunately that was not the case, and I know that Gemini Cat was wondering exactly that. As miserable as the clouds look today, I think it's really just a haze. I don't think the clouds don't seem to be too thick, and we can already feel the heat coming through, and I think once that sun gets an opening, it's going to burn away all the clouds, and we're going to be back in for the hot weather, which will be nice. We've had enough chilly days to last us a lifetime. It'll be nice to actually get into summer. They're the buffalo weavers that I was telling you about, building and always building their nest and reconstructing it. And it must be very frustrating, though, for those Wahlberg's eagles, because I know how annoying the buffalo weavers can be, because they're building a big nest outside my room in a big fever tree. Now, imagine if you're trying to sort of just roost, or, you know, just want a little quiet moment. You will not be able to achieve that with all the buffalo weavers around. They are the busiest birds, and they are some of the hardest workers. You see, there's quite a nice community of them through here. Isn't that lovely? Right, well, we're going to carry on from here. We're going to go back up Wahlberg's Road, and we're definitely going to crawl along, like I said earlier, so we don't miss any tracks. That's very important. We want to take it nice and easy, but we will do that. Right, I'm going to take it very, very easy along this road, and I'm going to keep you updated, and while I continue trying to track the kahunas, let's go to Jamie, who's got one of the most beautiful antelope in the bush.
Most definitely the most beautiful antelope in the bush, or certainly one of them, the long-legged and elegant kudu, joining the impala for their morning breakfast. What a lovely sight. And this particular stretch of road has actually proved to be relatively productive. Oh, look at the little horns. Look at this young male. His horns just poking through on the top of his head. I did have a herd of elephants here earlier, but they have vanished off. But that's wonderful. I really enjoy looking at young antelope. There you go. There's an impala that is fully grown. And those horns, of course, are solid bone. So they have to grow up from the top of the head. And when you think about that whole process, it's truly remarkable. Born without them, and then the steady process of laying down bone. It's a bizarre thought as a human being, laying down bone on the top of the head. I often wonder if it has a sort of an itchy, almost like teething. I often wonder if it's sort of itchy as that happens, as it starts to grow up from the top of the skull. They certainly tend to rub frequently. These impala rams that we've been looking at are all completely fully grown, except, wait, hold on, this one's not. This one is almost. His horns are almost at the full adult shape. They just haven't quite reached that upward curve that an adult fully grown impala ram would have. Interesting, it's been very interesting to watch the behavior of the impala rams over the last few weeks. I don't know what it is that's causing them to chase the females around, but they've... Oh, look at this one's scar. Is that a scar? Looks like it. That, I think, is from fighting other rams. And as I said, it's been interesting to watch them. They're fighting each other, they're chasing the females around, and I don't fully understand why, because it's not breeding season. Impala have a strict, strict breeding season, and the females, almost all of the females are pregnant at the moment, so I don't know what it is that's causing this, I don't know, interesting, passionate behaviour from all of the Impala rams. And you sit and watch on quarantine and they go sprinting past, chasing the females constantly. And I've just noticed it far more this season than I have any other year. Impala rams often get confused when it comes to mating season. And they often spar with each other and chase the ladies around. But this is to a new level this particular year. I don't know if it's to do with the drought, the lack of food, perhaps lack of rain. It seems to have confused them completely. For now, all is relaxed, though. No conflict with the Impala, as they nibble away. Good morning to Dispatch Griffin, as always, as our Impala scratches behind its ear. You want to know how high are Impala at the shoulder? That's a very good question, because, of course, we often forget to give you all a sense of scale, which I think is not unfair, because it's not intentional, but I think it is very, very difficult to get that sense of scale. So I would say, Dispatch Griffin, I would say they are probably around just under a meter and a half. So what would that be? Close to 4 feet, depending upon where you are. And my conversions are appalling. There you see. Odd behavior. What was that about? What did you spot? Sorry, Dispatch, I'll finish off my sentence in a moment. What's there? Ah, leopards are coming. That was so hopeful on my part. It was one alarm call and the alert Impala. I might be exaggerating slightly, but you never know. Could be. I can't go and check because this is Simbambili still. What have you seen? Don't mess with the eyesight of an Impala. They are so alert. Yes, no, what's there? Yes? Aw, false alarm. Got so excited. So much. As I said, you don't mess with the eyesight of Impala, but you also don't always have to take them seriously. They have been known to alarm call at other Impala. In other words, make that sharp barking alarm call that they do, just in response to something that they can see but they can't quite identify. Now, there's something there. There's something that's attracted their attention on that side. It could well be another herd of Impala, though. You don't mess with the eyesight of an Impala, but you don't necessarily have to take their word for it. Let's put it that way. What's there? Oh, man. Still alarm calls. And two of them are now paying attention to whatever's west of them. What's there? If it were a leopard moving, they would have identified... No, they're all stopped now. They would have identified it. Stopping to have a nibble, which they probably wouldn't do if they had a strong suspicion that there was a leopard walking past them. They are very, very useful eyes and ears of the bush, though. I can't see anything. I'm not convinced. I'm not sold. What are you alarm calling about? And a very warm welcome to M. Ruth, who is a new viewer, or at least the first time I've heard your name coming through on our questions. Welcome to our live safaris. You've sent through a question about whether or not our antelope will molt their horn, molt their antlers, in the same way other stags do. And the answer is no, they don't. So those, we were talking earlier about the fact that they are solid bone, and that is one of the defining differences between deer and antelope. So a deer has antlers, which is basically the equivalent, but made of hardened blood vessels that they can shed and they molt for throughout the year and throughout the breeding season. Whereas with antelope, that's one of the defining differences between the two. With antelope, that is solid bone, and there's no way that they can shed it in any way, shape, or form. They do occasionally lose their horns, but that's because they've been broken, and once they're broken, they don't ever grow back. Sorry, these impala are irritating me. They're not serious enough about it for it to be a predator. But this is almost where I left Tingana yesterday afternoon. And he was so full, I'm torn between saying he either was on patrol last night, or he just lay there and panted with an enormous belly. He looked as though he swallowed a beach ball. Let's go and have a look. It's very difficult when you've worked in the bush and you've lived in the bush for a long time. It's very difficult to ignore the alarm calls of antelope. And you shouldn't, for the most part, because, as I said, keen eyesight. But it's just not quite frantic enough. What? What are you seeing? Oh, the kudu looking as well. Oh, kudu are a bit more reliable. But I'm not 100% sure they're not looking at other impala. The kudu's now relaxed again. No, they've all started now. Hello, what have you seen? What have you seen that I have not? And is it coming this way? Because I can't go that way. No, this. See that alert posture? The impala that cried leopard. He's constantly alarm calling. But nobody else, everybody else is ignoring him. Now they're up, their heads are all up. I promise you, I will be distinctly irritated if you're alarm calling at other impala. But you can see their alarm calling. That sharp sound. I can't see anything except for other impala, and I mean, these guys look so relaxed. And that's the way impala alarm calls sometimes go. Somebody will lift up its head and go, "Leopard? I think I saw a leopard." And the other one will go, "Leopard, did you say leopard?" And start alarm calling with it. Just as all part of the herding instinct. It's only when they actually properly see them that they start making the frantic barks. I'm going to hazard a guess and say that these impala have created a false alarm. But, that being said, I'm not 100% certain, so I might sit here for a little bit longer. While I do, let's head back across to Taylor for an update on her side.
Good news, Herbie is on the tracks of the lion. We didn't see any more coming up along Wahlberg's Road. That's good. So it seems as though they're going east. I'm going to just try and check ahead of Herbert. And Herbie said he's going to stay on the tracks and try and keep following until he locates them. So definitely appreciating the helping hand from him this morning. Now, It was so exciting to find that barbet's nest yesterday. And the last few days I've been chatting about the magpie shrike nest. Today I will be going there. And Brian, if I don't go to the nest, I need some reprimanding. I don't know what the reprimanding is going to be, but I need reprimanding. So we're going to hopefully head up to Hyena Road. Hopefully once we found the lions this morning and spent a bit of time with them, then we'll be able to head over that way. But we'll try and get a little bit closer. For now, I'm backtracking. I'm driving on some roads that I have already driven. Just want to double make sure. Who's flying over there? There's lots of bird activity today. Everyone's flying towards sort of the sun. Actually, this is the first glimmer of hope we've had. You know, the lovely sort of the sound of the jigger that she makes. But have a look at the lovely sun coming through the clouds. Isn't that lovely? Sorry, I've parked on a bit of an angle. You just have to adjust you there. Look at that. Finally, some light. Isn't that lovely? And I think there's an opportunity for the sun to come out. And I think once it starts to get a few of its rays out, it's going to burn all those clouds away, as I said. You can see it's sort of just a fine mist that's moving through the sort of top of your screen. It's not very thick clouds, and the clouds are very high. I will be very impressed if we do get rain. Obviously, we never say no to rain. We want as much as we can to top up all the levels of the dam. Isn't that beautiful? While the rest of the sky is still quite grey. Lovely. All the birds are just starting to wake up. Well, possibly just the turtle doves are starting to wake up. And I'm going to sneeze. Excuse me, thank you. Let's carry on though. Let's try and keep up with Herbie. So he's not on his own. It's easier, obviously, the more people that help out, the easier it is. They've been giving us the slipperoo. What else have we got going on down here today? I'm having a quick scan, perhaps up in the trees. Maybe we even find a leopard. I haven't seen a leopard up in a tree for some time. I miss seeing the cats in the trees. We love checking these drainage lines. No, nothing here. Right. Get up over this hill. What else have we got? Haven't seen too many antelope around just yet. Occasional impala in the thickets. They don't seem to like me much. And I don't seem to be the giraffe whisperer either today. They're avoiding me. But I think we got such great shots yesterday. I was looking at all the screenshots from yesterday afternoon. Of all those three young giraffes that were sort of sparring with each other, they were beautiful. I also even managed to get a few good captures. I'm very excited to process them. Oh, we've actually got an impala up on the road ahead. Perhaps we will have a little look. No, and of course it's now moved off the road. It's like they're conspiring against me. They're sort of saying, oh, guys, Taylor's coming. Let's run, let's move. One day I'll get the impala to not run away from us. I just want to double check along this drainage that perhaps those lions didn't come a little bit further south. So I am just scanning across. As much as we need to put our heads on the ground to look for the footprints, it's also very important that we, of course, keep our eyes open and spot them. I've done that before where I've driven straight past lions because I was too busy following their tracks. Now I'm going to try and roll. Go, Jigger. Don't stop on me now. But of course, the impala have spotted me and are now running away, as you can see, behind the bushes. Why do they do this to me? And now let's try the other side. Maybe these ones on this side will be a little bit more willing. Yes, they are also walking away, but they seem to be walking away a little bit slower. Hello, impala. Lots of boys around at the moment as well. A few girls. There's a big male. Yeah, they're all looking lovely. You're looking a little bit ribby, but not too bad considering the horrendous drought that we've been experiencing. It'll be no time before they all plump up like normal. I'm very excited actually for the birthing season, because I believe that quarantine is incredible with a variety of game. And off he goes. Now, something that we notice in this area in particular, obviously if you exclude the wildebeest, pretty much all the other antelope that we see on a regular basis, the females don't have any horns, and then of course the males have horns. Now, the dark let me just get it all out this morning. I'm so sorry. Super tongue-tied. For some reason, my tongue decided it was going to stick to my palate and was going to stay there. So, sorry, dark tranquility. I cannot say anything this morning. I'm just going to leave it at that before I dig my hole deeper. Brian's got a big smile on his face. He's thoroughly enjoying me slurring my words this morning. And so you were wondering about the horns on antelope. Is there occasionally where males are born without horns, or do they get any deformities? And yes, of course. So I've actually experienced it. We rescued a bushbuck. This was many, many years ago, and we just found this bushbuck all on its own. It was thin, it was mangy, and I was living on a very small private reserve, and we had sort of a rehabilitation center. It wasn't a big open system like this, so we used to intervene a little bit. So anyway, we reared this bushbuck, and he was brilliant. Now, I'm sure you know how dangerous male bushbuck are. They are notorious. If you trap them in a dark corner, you'll be in a lot of trouble. And often when the males fight, usually one will end in a death. They're quite savage. And now, when we raised this bushbuck, we were so bizarre, because we could see he was a male. His coloration was a male. He had testicles like a male, but he had no horns, which is almost a blessing in disguise, because we're always worried when you habituate animals and they become used to people and relying on people. There's obviously a certain element of danger there, because you can't read their behavior as well as a wild animal. Now, we were obviously quite thankful that this male bushbuck just never grew horns, because it means he could only really headbutt you, and he couldn't stab you with his horns if he got upset with you. So that was quite nice. Seen it with kudu actually quite often as well, where their horns will twist and turn back and grow into their head. There's been a few cases of that recorded, so there's definitely an opportunity for deformities to happen. You know, it's just unfortunate. But I hope that answers your question, and I apologize on my tongue-tiedness this morning. But let's carry on in the search of the leons, and perhaps they have stopped moving around so we can keep up with them and try and find them again. It's really just beautiful with all the green that's popping out through the bush at the moment. Now, I'm going to continue the search for the elusive Nkuhumas, and I believe Jamie's got some elephants.
Well, I'm certain we're not the only ones that are appreciating the green flush that the bush is currently sporting. The elephants are enjoying it as well, particularly with the young knobthorns that are growing their fresh green summer leaves that make for a nice change, I think, for all of the animals out here. We've got a stunning view of this elephant bull. And speaking about horns and so on, and the fact that some antelope are born without the genes, for our new viewers, elephant tusks are, of course, a completely different kettle of fish. A weird mixed metaphor there. A completely different thing in that they are modified teeth. So, not bone at all, but modified incisors. But, that being said, you do get elephants that are born without tusks completely. It doesn't really hamper them, although a tusk is a useful thing. They use it for all sorts of different purposes, whether it's breaking branches or fighting each other, a defense mechanism. This young bull sports a particularly fine set of tusks. Hey, my boy? And luckily for us, he is far less camera shy than the other elephant that we stopped for. And you can see the maneuvering of the trunk and the branch, getting it to exactly the right angle. Quite a selective eater, this one. And there it disappears. Amazing. As we're watching it, you can actually see the hooked thorns that, as a human being, would instantly hook our skin. But for an elephant, is of absolutely no concern. Mouthful of thorns? Ha! Easy. Not a problem at all. Their mouths are so incredibly tough. It's almost incomprehensible. Ruthie in Florida, speaking of the toughness of an elephant, you want to know if I've ever felt the feel of or felt an elephant's skin? And the answer is yes, I have. You're saying you're curious about what it feels like. It's almost like touching warm bark, if I can describe it that way. It's incredibly rough and surprisingly hairy. Elephants are surprisingly hairy creatures. They don't look it because that hair is very sparse and, oh goodness. I've caused a traffic jam this morning. Let me just move out of the way, Ruthie. Morning. No idea who that was. Yes, it feels like warm bark. That's probably the best description I have. Their hairs are quite bristly and sparse on their skin, but when you feel it, you can really feel it's their hair is very, very coarse. I've been fortunate enough, I've been part of a few elephant darting processes, whether it's for relocating them, moving them around, treating them for various injuries. I have been one very memorable occasion where it's a long story, but suffice to say that an elephant bull came from one neighboring reserve and broke into the reserve I was working on, which isn't necessarily a problem. I mean, elephants, I love the fact that in South Africa animals can come and go, and they do. Cheetah, wild dog, they all move past the fences, and they'll go where they want to go. And in this particular case, this elephant bull, in a slightly more destructive way than, say, a cheetah or a wild dog, went over the fence, squashed it flat, and moved onto our reserve, which would have been fine except that the large bulls of the reserve that I was working on did not appreciate his arrival and consistently beat him up, essentially. They just, it's amazing the dynamic, and I'd love to know exactly what was going on inside their heads, but they really seriously injured him, and when we eventually darted him, we managed to find him and dart him, and he had these massive wounds on the inside of his mouth from where, which you wouldn't expect, but from where the tusks from the other elephant bulls had gone into his mouth and punctured the roof, the palate. And we did end up darting him, and that whole process is incredibly complex. It's a dangerous, dangerous thing darting any animal. Partly just because of the danger, because they're frightened, and also because of the drugs that you put into their system. You have to do it in certain circumstances, but it is very, very dangerous for them. M99 is a phenomenally potent drug. You've got to be so, so careful not to even touch the dart wound, where that dart has gone in, because that one tiny, minuscule drop of that substance can actually kill a human being. So you're dealing with seriously potent drugs. I've seen giraffe darting as well, by the way. Also a very interesting process. You've got to be careful that they don't injure themselves falling down, because that's quite the height to drop down from. Anyway, we darted this elephant bull and we shifted him and removed him, and he had to go onto the back of a massive truck. Turns out, if you get a flat tire when you have an elephant on the back of it, it makes life a whole lot more complicated. Presumably with a giraffe as well. In this particular instance, they had a flat tire, luckily, right outside our camp, and we spent that entire afternoon sprinting backwards and forwards to our water tank to cool him down. It's quite difficult to jack up a truck and change the tire when you've got an elephant on the back. But suffice to say, the skin is phenomenally coarse and tough. Shame. He then broke out again, as elephants do. Giraffe darting is a whole different kettle of fish. Can also complex in its own right. And the people that do these sorts of things, the vets and the game capture people that help to relocate animals to different places in South Africa, are, I almost want to say reckless. That's not the word I'm looking for, though. They're just very, very brave. And remember that we're very fortunate in where we are. We're sitting watching a pair of female giraffe in a massive wilderness area. But private reserves in South Africa are an enormous part of the conservation industry, private and fenced reserves. And in order to establish a conservation ethic in a conservation area, they obviously have to move animals around. Introduce them, reintroduce them in a lot of cases. Which means that giraffe do get shifted around, all animals get shifted around. And the people who do it are phenomenally skilled in what they do. And I've seen some amazing cases of animal capture where the people that are doing the capturing are so incredibly caring to the point that they will risk their lives to make sure that that animal is okay, that it is safe and that it is secure. And giraffe capture, for example, when you're moving giraffe from one area to another, involves a dart of the anesthetic, but then you can't dart them completely because you don't want them to run and fall over that massive height. And it involves driving up next to them and passing a rope across their chest and people running and wrapping that rope around them and then holding them back. These creatures are absolutely enormous. I know it's hard to picture, and I've got videos somewhere, I must actually try and find them, of giraffe capture. And it's always difficult to watch, but at the same time, when you know that it's a necessity and that it will do the animals good, ultimately, as a species, it is very, very impressive to witness. Bye-bye, giraffe. On that note, perhaps concerned by my talk of ropes and darts, would hardly blame them. There is an enormous amount of care and concern and work that goes into conservation of these animals throughout South Africa. This area is nice, it's huge, and therefore the level of interference is less. But there are people who have dedicated their lives to moving animals around. Right, speaking of moving animals, I want to go and find out where Tingana's wandered off to. He has not, unfortunately, I was hoping he had. He has not crossed Triple M. So in the meantime, let's head across to Taylor for an update, and I'll be back with you shortly.
We're finally on Hyena Road. Herbie's given me strict instructions. He says they've already crossed over Central and seem to be heading east. So I've quickly jumped onto Hyena Road, which is good news, because that means we're definitely going to stumble across that magpie shrike nest again, which will be fantastic. So I just also have to try and remember exactly where it was. And I'm also looking for tracks. So this is going to test my multitasking capabilities. But we will see. I think I should be all right. And of course, we've got lots and lots of roadblocks from the elephants who have been pushing down a number of trees over the last few months, really. We'll just avoid that one. Hello, Impala. Impala, have you seen anybody? Any lions? A magpie shrike by any chance? No? Okay. They're not very friendly today. Right. Now, I think, if I'm not mistaken, I did try and leave a little landmark for myself, a log on the side of the road as to where that nest was. Now, whether the elephants have perhaps pushed it away, or if a rhino, or if a buffalo or something has come up and rubbed on it, I'm not sure, but that will, of course, move it. I'm just going to drive very slowly, and I think we could be coming up to it shortly. Also, just like I said, scanning for those lions. Oh, I hope they're still around. Check here, this is a nice sandy spot. No lion tracks. None. Lions. Okay, I just want to double check. Is this where the nest was? No. It wasn't. If I'm not mistaken, I think it was in a tamboti tree. But I do stand corrected. It was also when Rusty needed to go to the emergency room. So I was like, this is good. This looks like lion dung. Can you see that over there, Brian? Was it a bit clear? Sorry, I'm just trying to shuffle out the way, but over there. That looks like lion feces. Now, it doesn't look like it's from a big one. Perhaps maybe it's quite small, actually. Perhaps it's from one of the cubs. But now I don't see any footprints really to go with it. The ground is not the greatest here. I'm just double checking. And I know that they've liked it here before. Right, let's carry on. Let's go very slowly along this section, because that is a great sign for us. One of the most promising signs we've actually had so far this morning. Okay. Let's see. It's so difficult, the sand. I have got their tracks though. Very good. They've gone up Hyena Road. Yes, I need to very quickly tell Herbie that I've got their tracks. Laura, I'll get your question now. Herbert Taylor. Herbie, I've got all the tracks going straight up Hyena Road. I'm going to try and stay on them. Yeah, FM, it seems that way. Just north of that mud wallow, you'll see the Nkonzo, also Bugo the Machimba. Okay, now that I've let Herbie know what the plan is, I'll get back to you now. Okay, let's just confirm. Copy. Fantastic. Now, you can see there's a lot of impala around here. Now, I wonder if these lions perhaps hadn't moved through this area much earlier. And that's why these impala are now here. Because normally we wouldn't see such a large group of impala being quite relaxed if there was a group of lions walking straight down the road, which it seems as though they have. Now, I love how they always stop and quickly listen, just to make sure that there isn't anything. No, impala, it seems to just be us for now. But it would be helpful if you could tell me which way the lions went. And Zara, you were wondering if I'm not afraid of the animals in the vehicle. We're relatively safe. And remember, all of us, we're all very well trained in animal behavior. And that's the most important thing, is if you can read the behavior of these animals, then you know when they're going to sort of change their mind, and when they aren't comfortable with you anymore, perhaps they're a bit agitated, they won't just charge us. They'll give us subtle signs which we're able to read, and then as guides we try and be as ethical as possible. We then try and move away and give them a little bit of room. Now finally the impala seem to be relaxed with me. How's this beautiful big male? Hey, lovely, he's going back around. There's obviously a few females that are perhaps getting out of line, though it's quite a mixture here. There's lots of males, lots of females, young males, old males, you name it, they're all here. Yeah, so this is not good for us. I suspect that these lions have moved on quite a bit. Well, let's not dawdle too much then. I think we're going to have to try and keep a move on so we can try and keep up with these lions. Because if they're going north, we know what that means. There's always that possibility they could cross out of our traverse. Now, I've seen these in Kahumas. They travel ridiculous distances. It's actually quite impressive with those little ones. They sort of just drag them behind and they've got to carry on. Now, I just want to keep making sure if I have got any sign of them, any tracks, but it doesn't look like it just yet. So perhaps they've veered off the road. I'll have to tell Herbie. Now, beyond that mud wallow we just passed earlier, they do like to veer off and go down into the drainage line. It's obviously almost impossible for us to drive in that drainage. Ooh, hang on. Herbie's trying to talk to me again. Let me pay him a bit of attention. Go, Herbie. Right. Yeah, FM, Herbert, come up Hyena Road, and then there's that one big mud wallow that's on the eastern side of the road. Just north of that, you'll see the Machimba and you'll go all the Nkonzo. I've lost it now, though. I think they went off east into the drainage. I'm just going to continue towards Bafulsuk Dam. Right. So Herbie and I've got a plan, and hopefully we're now zoning in on these lions. I'm just still checking about the tracks. Okay. So it seems as though they definitely have veered off into the drainage. So Herbie's now trying to jump a little bit further east of where I am. and perhaps we'll get them somehow. I'm going to head towards Biffle's Hook Dam now. So Herbie's chatting again. Copy, thanks. Right. Let's go towards Biffle's Hook Dam. And while I slowly make my way there in anticipation to find the Nkuhumas, let's go see if Jamie has found Tingana yet.
I'm afraid to say no sign of Tingana and no tracks coming in the sort of easterly direction either. So I figured, well, why not? We'll go and check where he was. Perhaps he was feeling particularly lazy last night with his full belly. We never ever established what it was that he was eating. I have absolutely no idea. He was eating something. He must have been. I don't know whether he had it somewhere hidden in that drainage line, maybe in the river system that runs through the dam. Maybe there was food there. He just wasn't interested in feeding on it yesterday afternoon. Oh, why not? We'll go and check and see. Perhaps Shadow distracted him to the point that he didn't move very far. The only thing is that a couple of herds of buffalo, elephant, and other animals have moved across the road, so we might have missed his tracks. I don't think so, though. I've been basically crawling this morning. I have covered very, very little distance, just going really slowly trying to see if we can spot the tracks. And of course I have VM on the back, and if I miss the tracks, I know that VM's got my back in that regard. He is on the ball when it comes to spotting tracks like that. He hasn't come this way either. We were discussing yesterday about the fact that leopards and all big cats, actually, in terms of territory, when it does rain, they do have to go on a patrol. They have to go and re-scent mark their usual bushes, make sure that everybody knows. And in leopards, in the case of leopards, it's male and female. They have to go and make certain that everybody knows that this is their territory and this is their spot. Which makes it wonderful weather for big cat viewing if you happen to encounter them. And yesterday Tingana was calling, as I mentioned, which makes me suspect that it just seems unlikely that he's where we left him. But let's try. Who knows? We still don't know what he killed. Maybe he still had a meal going. I do know that either way, it's a good thing that he had a full belly, because Shadow was most intent on distracting him from anything outside of her. Quiet here. Massively noticeable difference between Arethusa and Djuma. They're right next to each other. The distance between them is so incredibly small, and yet the amount of rain that Arethusa has had, I'll stop and have a look, compared to Quarantine, for example. This is Knobthorn Open. The grass growth is significantly less. Amazing, isn't it? Just less than a few miles difference, and there's hardly any grass here. It's still looking thoroughly dry. And the same goes for some of the reserves to the south of us are completely barren. They've had absolutely no rain, which explains the presence of multiple buffalo herds, lots of elephants. Okay. Everybody keep your fingers crossed. Hopefully it'll be as easy as yesterday afternoon, where I just drove past Red Dam and went, oh, there's a leopard here. It was one of the easiest leopard finds I've ever had. Now, speaking of our leopard couple, and particularly the bond between them, Michael, good morning and welcome, as always, to the Sunrise Safari. You wanted to know how many times Shadow will have to mate to get pregnant, because, as you say, we have heard about her mating with Tingana for a long time now. I think it's well over 2 months. And you were wondering if she was perhaps struggling to get pregnant. I hesitate... I'm hesitant to actually answer that because I don't really know. It's so difficult without knowing, being able to follow that animal for for a more extended time period than we do. It's normal for a female that has lost cubs, as she has, although Shadow's case is a little bit different, but it's normal for a leopard or any animal that's lost a youngster to go through a series of estrus cycles before they fall pregnant again. But whether or not she's struggling to fall pregnant, well, I don't think so. No more than your average big cat. Not every mating session is successful, which we've seen with the young Kahuma lioness, for example. Or we saw with Karula, where she was mating multiple times with Tingana before she actually fell pregnant. So it's difficult to answer because I think that Shadow, there's something odd about Shadow's estrus cycles. The fact that she goes into estrus while she still has a very young cub, I think is testament to the fact that her hormones are all over the place. That's just my opinion, but we don't know. We would never know unless we actually were able to closely examine her and test her constantly. And of course, we'll never know if she perhaps just got unlucky. We don't know what precipitated. Well, no, we do actually. That's not true, because her cub was seen very briefly. It's raining. Odd drop of rain. Her cub was seen very briefly while she was mating with Tingana. It was seen in the bush and then it disappeared. It ran away. So she did go into estrus with that little cub still alive. Hello, Elise. Have you seen a leopard here this morning? No answer. It seems to be an elephant-filled morning this morning. I think these are the same elephants that we encountered on Triple M that have just moved through towards Red Dam. I'm going to come back to these elephants. I just want to check. The longer we leave it, the further away, and especially if there's a herd of elephants walking towards this area, the longer we leave it, the further away Tingana is going to get. The fact that he hasn't gone east, I just want to check properly. And we'll come back to these elephants. I think they're on their way for a drink anyway. And who knows? We're close enough to Djuma, it could easily be Fang's herd, which would of course mean that the little baby was with them. Fang is an easily identifiable elephant. Hello, do you mind if I come past? It's okay. It's all right. Don't be naughty, mister. Yes. Finish your knobthorn. It's quite a nice view. Do you mind if we sit here for a bit, mister? Young elephant ball. We've just got such a lovely view of him. Here he goes, using his tusks to break off the branches. And you can see they're sort of vervent green. Beautiful colours. The knobthorns are always the first trees to get knocked over in summer. Hey, mister. It's a jolly good breakfast. Oh, Viola, welcome to the Sunrise Safari. We were talking about tusks and horns and the growth of those things. You wanted to know if there is a blood supply in an elephant's tusk. To an extent. There will be a blood supply at the root and then a little bit into the tusk itself, along with the nerve supply. So like your teeth, that have the sort of internal layer of nerves and blood and capillaries, the tusk will have that as well, but it doesn't extend very far beyond where the tusk sticks out of the elephant's face. I've been trying to do a little bit of research into just how far that canal extends. into the tusk itself, and it seems as though it doesn't go very far beyond where the tusk actually surfaces. But there is a blood supply and there are nerves, which is why if an elephant gets a crack in its tusk and it happens to contract an infection, they can be exceptionally grumpy, and you can hardly blame them, because it's like having a toothache, but the tusk is absolutely massive, and obviously you've got that weight on top of everything else, leaning down on an infected tooth. It must be excruciating. Those of you who've had toothache before, you'll know what I'm talking about, that pain that goes into your head. And you can see this. You can see the sort of fault lines in this particular tusk, the cracks. Oh boy. And those aren't serious, that's just natural growth. This is just the natural growth patterns of the ivory. But yes, the blood supply does extend a little bit into the tusk. And there's lots and lots. There was a case not so long ago where there was an elephant in Baluli, which is open to this reserve, where there was a particularly angry elephant, and it turned out that he had a massive infection in his tusks. Well, it seems as though Taylor is having more luck than myself this morning with the leopards. Let's go and see who she has found.
And I'm sure that this beautiful leopardess needs absolutely no introduction. It is indeed the queen herself, Madame Karula. Now, yesterday she gave us the slip away. Apparently she went all the way south of the traverse and perhaps did a bit of a walkabout, didn't find anything, and now she's on the most northern boundary. Isn't that exciting? Now, she's perched herself beautifully up on top of this termite mound. But she hasn't got her cubs here. Perhaps they are stashed away somewhere. Maybe she needed a little bit of a break from them. As we've seen, they can be quite boisterous and energy-consuming for a poor Karula. But isn't this lovely? I'm glad that she's popped her head up a few times, because she was sleeping. And I know it's not the lions that we found, but I'm happy. I'm very much enjoying Karula. I think she is beautiful. And she reminds me so much of a leopard down in the south that I was very fond of. Her name was Lisbon. And they sort of have pretty much the same mannerisms. Enjoy sitting up in trees, enjoy sitting up on termite mounds. And just very regal. She's lovely. She almost looks a little bit the same as well. But different. Same, but different. That's a very famous saying in South Africa. We tend to say that all the time. You can see how she's just turning around, looking over her shoulder. Like I said, I think she's a little bit traumatized from the last few experiences she's had. Oh, give us a big yawn. Oh, lovely. I think she's going to get on the move. Hello, big girl. Oh, look at that stretch. Isn't that beautiful? I'm going to snap one or two shots of her for my beautiful Karula collection. And it is actually building up quite nicely. Isn't that beautiful? What an incredible cat this is. Now, I'm hoping maybe she has dropped her cubs off. You can see she doesn't look particularly fat, and that she's going to go on the hunt for us. So we're definitely going to stick with her. So I'm going to turn around very quickly so we can try and keep up with her. Right, that's lovely. Brian, are you happy to see a leopard?
Very happy.
Brian and the thumb are extremely ecstatic, just as I am. Oh no. Taylor, what is going on with you? It's like I need to... I'm not winning today. I don't know why. Between the squeaky brakes and me not being able to drive. No, we'll get there. We will get there. I promise I'm not... Okay. We'll just hold the key in a little bit longer. I'll practice this afternoon. That's what I'll be doing in between drives. Thanks, Karula, for not racing off. Jigger, you are definitely an interesting character. Right, let's get Madam over here, who's going to cross the road. Now, don't lead us through too thick vegetation. Now, hopefully she's going to find herself something like a little steenbok or a common dacre. So we'll give her a bit of room, because we don't want to startle the antelope. If she does see something, you can see her just disappearing through there. She's on a little game path. I'm going to just keep the engine running because I'm going to have to keep going. Now I'm just trying to see what her next move is. Are you going to go and scratch on the tree? Let's see. I think she may mark up against that tree. Having a little sniff, you can see, head right down on the ground. And now I need to try and find a way in here, because otherwise she's going to disappear. And we may lose her. Come on, Jigger. I'm going to have to head over this little tree over here to get in. Just going to reverse quickly. Right, sorry little tree, but I know you're going to bounce back up. Sorry everyone, everyone's now trying to get hold of me. Mike, please make your approach. She's now mobile sort of south. We're just on the fire break and the western access to Biffle's Hook Dam. Right, let's go through here. Good. She's right here. Yeah. Sorry, she's coming right up to the vehicle. I'm going to turn the game drive radio off very quickly. Look how she's marking right here. Hello, beautiful. And she's just slinking past her. I'm just trying to duck so you can see her. Off she goes. Hello, beautiful girl. There she goes. Now, we're going to have to do lots of off-roading today, which is going to be fun in between all these bush willows and terminalias. It's quite thick, so we're going to try and find the clearest route. However, don't know how clear it's going to be. Okay, right. I think we're going to have to squeeze through here. Brian, are you ready? So I apologize if I don't always chat to you as I make my way through here. Going to have to do a little bit of concentrating as Karula can maneuver through this area a lot easier than I can. Right, now we will just ponder along here. Mind that little branch. Luckily there doesn't seem to be too many thorn trees just yet. Go Jigger. She's marking. She's making it very difficult for us. Sorry, little tree. I know you're going to pop back up again. That's what I love about some of the vegetation. Ooh-ee. Okay, well, I don't want to upset Karula, so I'm just also going to watch my distance. Lots of obstacles in the way. Right, where are you going to go next? You can see her just walking through there. Ideally, I want to get up in front of her, but that is not always possible. Go sneak through here. There's another termite mound coming up. Perhaps she's going to go and perch herself on top of that. I'm going to have to just quickly, I'm going to quickly zip around her. So hard to get through here. Okay, oh, Brian, watch the thorns on the right. That's a nasty one. We're going to have to duck and dive underneath this little bit over here. Are we ready? Duck. None of us gets our heads hit. That's a wonderful English today. Apparently, I've just woken up, but my brain hasn't quite got up just yet. Now, where are you going to go next? Try and follow her again. She just goes wherever she likes. Gonna roll forward. So she's pausing every now and then. You can see her just moving through the leaf litter to sort of scan. You see that? Look at how that tail sort of twitches. I love that. That reminds me, it's like her brain is working. Her brain is thinking. So she definitely looks like she's looking for something to eat. And there would indeed be a lot of common dacre and a lot of steenbok around here. Now it's getting very thick, but we shall persevere. Jigger, are you ready for today? Jigger, you're going to have to look for all sorts of things, right? It's also making it quite difficult that it's just us following her. Okay, let's go through this little gap here. Sorry, Brian, with all the trees. Oh, well, at least they're not thorn ones. Just got to make sure that we don't lose the aerial. We've got all these sorts of things. Good. Well, we're as good as we're going to get. Go slowly. Another one. Watch. This is not a nice one. Take that. Off you go. All right, we'll try and keep going. Very difficult now. I can't see the queen anymore, so I need to pick up the pace slightly to try and keep up with her, because if we lose her in here, we're in trouble. Got that. Karula, why do you blend into the vegetation so well? Oh, it's getting very thick. Very, very thick. Where did she go? Did you see where she went? Also lost her. Now she's slinking around. She, like I said, she goes in and out of these bushes very easily. It's a little bit more difficult for us. Where did you go? She was coming in this direction. Completely lost her. I don't know where she's gone, but she was gonna try and stick in the direction that she was going, and hopefully we'll catch up to her. Oh, there she goes. I've got her. Okay, let's go over this. She's just slinking down ahead to us into this drainage. Now, it's an area that leopards love to hunt is the drainage lines. It provides a lot of cover. Now, we need to just find a little way through here. It's probably not going to be the most beautiful and elegant driving that you've seen. However, I will do anything I can in order to show you that's not going to work. It's a bit thick. I think we're going to have to try. There she goes on top of the mound. I think we're going to have to try. Let's go through. Let's push through here. Jigger's probably done much worse before, but that's what these vehicles are built for. They are tough vehicles that are capable of doing anything. I'm just going to get whacked by the thorns. Okay, and I've spotted my route, and I need to try and keep with it. Are you ready, Brian? My goodness. Luckily, they're not big trees. They're just lots and lots of little ones. Good, Jigger. You can do it, Jigger. Oh, good girl. She's sitting up there. I'm going to go around her again so we can get her front on. This is, goodness gracious, this is off-roading 101. Hi, girl, you thought you could avoid us. Ooh, there we go, sorry about the squeaky brakes. And we've got Herbie again. Now, she's moving quite nicely. We're back on Hyena Road again. We're almost on Hyena Road. I just had Herbert driving past. Now, what are you going to do now? She's just going to slink in between from termite mound to termite mound, using it as a vantage point. And if she does that, and you see how in between she's marking territories too. Now, something that I absolutely love, and I'm so glad that Curious One has brought it up this morning. You're wondering if I also think that leopard urine smells like popcorn. Yes, it does. Particularly from a male, I find that the scent is way more prominent, and I often slam on the brakes to have a little sniff. It's beautiful. It's something that I like. Brian and I were actually discussing different scents, and he quite enjoys the musty smell you get from an elephant bull, as well as from the waterbuck, and he loves the sweet, stinky scent of the wild dogs. Now, there's another creature that also has a scent like popcorn, like, I'm going to carry on going to try and keep up with her, very much like the leopards do, and that's genets. Is that genets as well? When they urine, it'll smell like popcorn. Now, you see, there's a lot of sickle bush here, and I don't want to drive over the sickle bush because I know that will end up in having a flat tire. Sorry, Brian, I have to sneak over here and try and get around and keep up with her again. Okay, now I'm going to go over this one. Actually, Brian, do you mind if we sneak under this quarry tree? Right, let's see what caterpillars come out underneath us. We're going to do a little bit of ducking here. But then, Roy, it's just, my goodness. Now, I always wonder if while you're watching this, are you also ducking as we duck underneath the branches? Karula, where did you go? Did you see her? She keeps doing this. She keeps disappearing just out of my... Oh, there, she's at the next tree. Okay, thank goodness. It's proving quite difficult to keep up with her. Oi! That was a big bump. Karulakins, can we just slow down the pace a little bit here? I'm just going to duck so you can see her over her shoulder. Here she is. Where are your children? Where did you leave them? It would be nice if you could go and find them for us, please. Look at those markings, though. They are so beautiful. Oh, there she is. Just slinking past us. Okay, it seems as though she's possibly going to go back to the road again. Please go back to the road again, because it's a lot easier to follow you then. Going to... just turn the vehicle around so we keep up with her. I need to very quickly update the sighting as well. Karula's now mobile, sort of south or west, southwest down Hyena Road. It's just myself here. I turned my radio off for a little bit, just so we could appreciate her. Here she is. Please stay here, don't go into that drainage line. Now, remember, we just drove this road, and do you remember how many impala we saw? So I'm hoping, though, that she's going to come across some of those large herds of impala that we saw probably only 15 or 20 minutes ago. It wasn't too long. I don't think they would have gone too far. So I'm going to give her quite a bit of space, because you know that the impala don't like me too much. And Morning Glory, I know that you are having a good chuckle at me this morning about how Karula is giving me a crash course in how she travels. And that's why I say she's very, very similar to that other leopardess I was telling you about, Lisbon. She did a very, very similar thing, where she would move in and out from Termite Mountain, then she'd go up a Marula and stand and have a look. It was quite beautiful. Karula's just off in the distance. I'm going to try and stick on the road, because I don't think I'm going to be able to maneuver to where she's heading to now. Have her over here. There you go, you can see her again. Twitching that tail. Thinking perhaps there's something in there that we can't see. Oh, she's just going to have a look. Like I said, we're going to keep our distance now, because she's moving into these nice drainage areas, like I said, that are filled with steenbok, filled with impala and common dacre. And as soon as they hear us crashing through the bushes, those antelope will become very suspicious, and I'm sure that they will race away. We don't want to ruin any attempted hunts for her. We'll just give her quite a bit of room here. Hopefully we won't lose her. She likes to disappear. As Morning Glory said, look at that tail. Isn't that beautiful? How it twitches like that. And that is so typical of them when they do start to hunt or when they show any interest. They will twitch it around like that. Now, I'm not sure if she's seen anything, though. She hasn't started sort of crouching. She's just sitting, having a look. There's a... Can you see the Natal Spurfowl just down to her left? It's just walking in front. Look at that. Oh, it's a crested Franklin, sorry. She's completely not bothered by it. Catch it. She must have seen something else. She's not bothered by that crested Franklin that was literally inches away from her. Perhaps there's something else in there. You can see that tail working quite a bit. I must say, I think those Franklins are some of the most fearless birds. We've seen them going up to lions. We've seen them walking inches away from leopards now. They're a lot braver than I am. Something else caught her attention. If she only knew that she had to go another 50 meters or so, maybe even a bit further, and she would come across about 50 impala that she could choose from. But I'm very excited to stick with her this morning. Hello, beautiful girl. She is lovely. She obviously appreciated that comment as she gazed back towards us, and I think she's watching the Franklins now. They're moving past her. Off they go. They've just gone out of the screen to the left. Very brave birds. Bye-bye. You got lucky, because if those cubs were around, I don't think you would have been so lucky. Now she's giving herself a quick groom. Lick of the paw. She's going to come back towards us now. She's going to rest for a little bit. And you won't believe it, I can hear those southern ground hornbills again in the far distance. Isn't it so lovely that we know that we've got this beautiful family that lives around in the area and that we occasionally see? This is quite typical, though, for leopards to sort of start and stop throughout their hunt. She's marked her territory in between. She's sort of doing quite a few things on her long list that she needs to do today. Just need to very quickly chat to Andrew. I think he'd like to come to the sighting. Okay. Let me quickly chat to Andrew. You'll go, Andrew. If you'd like to make your approach, you're welcome to. Just come straight down Hyena Road from the cut line, from the Vossel cut line. You'll get my visual. Having a good groom. Just checking that there's maybe she got a thorn or something in her foot while going through the treacherous drainage lines. And we've been seeing her marking her territory quite a lot, and it's something that is quite astounding to me. And it's a question that Robin P. would like to know, is do the cats ever run out of urine while marking their territories? Now, I've never seen it, and I don't understand how they can store so much urine in their bodies as well. It's quite impressive if you've ever followed a leopard from waking up to going out on a full territorial patrol, which could last hours. They constantly keep marking. So I've never seen them run out before. It's the same thing with rhinos. It blows my mind how they're able to urine spray and to quite large quantities as well. So that's quite amazing how they're able to do that.
So no, I don't think so. I think at some point, yes. But I don't think it runs out very quickly. I suppose when you rely on marking your territory with urine, you must have some special ability to be able to keep producing it at quite a fast rate. Giving herself a good clean. Well, I'm glad that she settled down for the moment, though. It was getting quite tricky in trying to follow her. But perhaps she will continue. We can only just sit here and wait and see. I don't think she will be down for too long, though. I think she's going to get up after she's had a little bit of a groom. When Herbert found her, she had her eyes closed on the termite mound, so I think she did have a little siesta already. Remember, if you have perhaps just stumbled across us, or if you've only just tuned in, we are live. This is all happening right now. And if you'd like to ask any questions, myself or Jamie would happily try and answer them to the best of our ability. And you can do that by either hashtagging SafariLive on Twitter, or alternatively, you could send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. I'd love to hear from you. Having another look back at us. Now, I'm sure you're probably wondering why I don't go a bit closer, because we're quite far away from her. We're probably about 50 or 60 meters away from her. But I don't think there's any need. I think we can just take a little bit of a long distance view of her, and perhaps then if she does get up, maybe she comes and walks straight towards us like she did earlier. I don't think it's always necessary to get up close and personal. Sometimes it's nice to take a little backseat view and just gaze from the distance. But we are spoiled, aren't we, with the leopards and the lions, how close they come to the vehicle. Now, something that amazes me is that she is able to drop her cubs off. And I don't know, I would lose them. If I had to drop my cubs off somewhere, I don't think I'd ever remember where to go back and find them. Now, Andrew wants to know, how well do the cats know their terrain? Now, Andrew, just with the statement I've made, they know the property like the back of their hand. She's an older girl. She has been traversing this area for many, many, many years, for much longer than I have even been in the industry for. So she will know favorite spots. Remember, she marks certain trees on a regular basis, and it sort of becomes inbred, like how we have to go out and learn the roads. She'll do the same thing, but she's been doing this for many, many, many years now, and it's just incredible. So I think by using things like the markings, the scent markings that would have helped her initially, finding her way around when she left her mother. And now she's the queen. This is her land. She'll know everybody and everything that comes onto this property as she's walking and picking up all the different scents. Must be an overload of information at times. She's settling down quite a bit now. Come on, girl, we would really like to see a hunt. I haven't seen a leopard hunt in a while. I believe you did see a leopard hunt not so long ago, though. And I'm mistaken. Was it Karula? Maybe you can help me out a little bit. I think it was while I was on my holiday, my vacation. And I think you got to see it with Brent. So who hunted the common dacre? I'd love to hear as to who exactly that was. Perhaps it was Karula. Maybe it was somebody else, I'm not certain, but that is something quite special to see. And I'm so glad you all got to witness something like that. Here we go, big girl. No, just changing sides. Cats spend quite a bit of their day grooming themselves. Whenever they get that opportunity, normally it's just before they wake up. think we're going to hang around with Karula just for a little bit longer. And I'm going to keep close eyes on her, make sure she doesn't slip out of sight again. But I think let's go across to Jamie and see how her morning is going.
Whilst Taylor's doing a fantastic job of keeping up with Karula, my efforts concerning the location of two leopards have not gone so well. I don't know where these leopards have gone. As far as I can tell, they've flown or teleported away from where we last saw them. Or, it's old hyena tracks. Got excited there for a moment. I thought I'd found some leopard tracks. Or they went north into Simbambili. Those are the few conclusions. The light this morning is difficult for tracking, making seeing the tracks particularly tough. But I don't think I've missed any. As I mentioned earlier, I've basically been crawling this morning. I don't think I've missed their tracks. I think they've just teleported. They either have some kind of, I don't know, wormhole or something, or they have secret underground tunnels, or leopards can actually secretly fly. That's my conclusion, because they have not left a single footprint on the road. And I've been checking really carefully. And in fact, life around Arethusa's Red Dam is relatively quiet. Apart from those elephants that we were with earlier, there's not that many general game species. That's just notable in terms of the impact that the lack of rain has had. Oh, sorry, Viam, that nearly went into your head. Got to be careful driving over sticks. You never know when they're lying and waiting in ambush. No, it's still that hyena walking along the road. Okay, we've checked east, south, and... Well, we're checking south now. We've checked east and west and south. I think the only remaining conclusion is that those leopards have gone north towards Simbambili. The one thing I did do was sit for a considerable period at Red Dam with those elephants, and I did not hear the sound of mating leopards. I don't know whether Shadow just went into the area that Tingana was in just to investigate, to see what he was calling about, or if she did actually go there to seek out a mate, or a male leopard to mate with. My suspicion is that she was looking for him to mate with, and I didn't hear any sound of leopards. If they were there together, we would have heard them. Let's go over to Taylor, see what's happening.
So we've got Karula again. She's up. And we've just spotted some impala. It's going to be very difficult to try and show you because they're behind some very thick vegetation. I just saw a few tails swatting the flies away. But they're not far. The impala may be about 50 or 60 meters away from her. And she's got lots of really, really good cover. So I'm going to let her try and get into position. And I'm not going to do too much moving. I think we've got a good spot for now. But I'd like to allow her to get a little bit closer. See how she's going to... She's sitting down. She's just watching. She's waiting for the perfect moment. And that's the key when you are hunting, is patience. I mean, a hunt for a leopard or a lion could go from taking 2 minutes to 2 hours. It's a lot of planning involved, and she knows she's got two young cubs to think about. And ideally, if she can catch an impala, like we've seen, they feed on it for a good 3 days. Gets her off the hook for a little bit. So we're just going to hang tight and just see what she does, what her next move is going to be. She's got incredible eyes, though. I can't believe that she spotted those impala from where she was, because they are behind such thick vegetation. And I think it is that those big herds, that we saw earlier, perhaps they've moved further up north now. And we saw there were plenty, plenty, plenty impala. Now, it's, can you see them there, bro? So it looks like a fallen tree. If you go a little bit further right, they're all down in here. Like I said, they're behind very thick vegetation. So we'll do a slow little pan and see if you can't pick up the movement of the tail. There we go. You can see a few legs. See that? There's one there. Now there's lots of, there seem to be lots of them here. She's still waiting. The impala, like we see them do, they're feeding, walking in circles, going forward, going backwards, going left, going right, trying to pick up on as much food as they can. Oh, there's a big herd of impala. Come on, girl. Oh, my word, they're being chased by an elephant. Look, the impala, there's an elephant now coming through the bushes. Look at that. You see the elephant coming through now? Now, that's exactly where the impala were. I wondered why the impala all of a sudden picked up their pace. And thank you, Brenda, for letting me know that it was indeed Karula that did the live hunt. Maybe we'll be lucky enough to see another one. Now, that's quite interesting. This is now unfortunately going to ruin the plan of Karula's hunt, or perhaps maybe work in her favor. Maybe that elephant, as he comes moving through there, he chases the impala towards us, or towards where Karula is waiting patiently. Sorry, I'm just trying to move out of the way here and watch what's going on around us. I need to keep an eye out on that elephant, of course. See if we can, no, we can't roll any more forward. Like I said, I don't want to start the vehicle and make too much noise. I can't see where those impala have gone now. Just trying to have a little look through all the bushes. That elephant doesn't even know that she's here. Not that a big elephant bull would be really worried about a little leopard. May chase it away, but I don't think there'd be very much trumpeting like we often see and we have seen when the elephants encounter lions, and particularly the breeding herds tend to react far more towards the presence of a cat than a big elephant bull would. Come on, Karula, what's your next plan? Her patience is incredible, though. Brian, can you see where those impala went? I also can't see. Oh, okay, I see one moving now. They look like they've changed direction a little bit and seem to be coming towards us, but not by much. But they're a little bit further ahead, sort of where Karula is, just sitting a little bit further down from where she is, and then straight to the right. They're all in there. Well, there's also quite a bit of sort of ups and downs. The terrain doesn't seem to be too flat, which would also work in her advantage. And if she just sat where she was now and laid flat on the ground, I don't think those impala would even see her. Okay, I see the elephant has now moved off completely. I just saw his ears disappearing down into the distance, which is good. Lots of birds also starting to chit and chatter in the background as well. And it's warming up. I'm going to have to take my jersey off soon. See how she's pricked her ears up again? She's listening. I think she's seen that elephant, though. That's, I think, what Karula is now looking at down in the distance. Now, if I were her, I would actually get up and run a little bit further forward because she's got plenty of cover. I don't think they would see her, and when she walks, she almost walks so silently that you wouldn't even hear her. There's a bit of a breeze as well. I think that's possibly what she's a little bit worried about, is that the wind seems to be swirling very slightly at the moment. And if she does move, perhaps she's worried that her scent is going to be blown straight down towards those impala, which she doesn't want. You know, the impala have got very, very keen senses, eyesight, hearing. We don't want that to give the presence away of Karula. Her tail doesn't seem to be as jumpy as it was earlier. I think now that she's seen what she's interested in, she's going to sit quietly and wait. Sorry, you may have heard Louise chatting away there. Hello, Louise. And you heard exactly who Louise is talking about. Andrew, good morning. Andrew would like to know, what is the risk of infection if a thorn does get stuck in her paw? Now, Andrew, they're very good at being able to remove the thorns from the inside of the padding of their foot. They've obviously got those lovely hard bristles on their tongues, and if that doesn't work, then she can always try and actually use her teeth and physically pull it out, which we often see. So infection-wise, if she can keep that wound clean, so if she keeps licking it, I think she'll be fine. It's not really too bad. But, you know, I think it's always hard for the animals to try and look after a wound that's in a spot where they cannot reach and they can't keep licking and they can't keep clean. That elephant is disappearing into the distance again. He's just crossed the road. I don't know if we can see him. He just crossed over there and down he went. I think that's what Karula was having a look at. So even with that, the male lion had an injury on his face. The Mfumo. Well, he must have been very frustrated that he wasn't able to keep that wound nice and clean. And I think if he could have, if it perhaps was an injury on his paw, if he had something similar on another part of his body that he could have kept clean by licking, I think it would have healed a lot quicker too. But they are so resilient, these animals. They fight off diseases and infections all the time, much better than we as any humans could. Obviously, we have the help of medicine. Now, I can see that Andrew is, I can hear him, he's coming up behind me. So what I want to do is, I do want to just get us into a better position. So I'm going to move forward now. Impala seem to actually have changed their position again and have moved away. So let's quickly just try repositioning so he can also get a little bit of a view. Hello, girl. Just gonna pull up over here. And you can just see her. Andrew, there's Maningi Mala. Yeah. I'm just telling Andrew about all the impala that are just in the distance. We don't want to move around too much. Obviously, we don't want to scare the impala. But now I can't see the impala anymore. I think they've moved further into the bushes. They don't know that she's here. But you can see she seems to be a lot more relaxed than what she was. Oh, now I've spotted an impala again. She hasn't, though. She's fast asleep, but they're not far. Like I said, she's got great cover here. Let's see what her next move is. She's looking a bit tired now. I can even see a warthog. There's a variety of different animals in the bushes. So it's a perfect opportunity for her. Now she's looking over her shoulder. No, no, look straight ahead. You'll see a warthog. You'll see all the impala. Come on, girl. Look back at us. You're missing out. There we go. Now you can see those ears have pricked up again. I think a big warthog could be a little bit too big for her. She's got a clear view now of the impala. She's looking straight at them. She's even got a termite mound in her favor that she could sneak right up to. So I'm not sure why she hasn't decided to sneak around. But we will be patient. You know, that's the only thing that gets us through sightings like this, is just sitting, keeping your fingers crossed. Lots of patience. Starting to get a little tongue-tied again, so I just need to have a very quick sip of water in case you hear me gulping down something. Come on, girl. Thumbs up to the thumb. Well, Anna Marie, you heard your question being asked live, and Brian heard it loud and clear as well. We apologize. Some of the voices seem to be sneaking through the little mixer box. But Brian says, thank you very much. And I'm sure the thumb is very happy with that comment too. You've probably made the thumb's day. So thank you, Anna Marie. Now, Karula, you would make our day if you went and hunted something, because you have got a choice between venison and pork. Now, which one would you prefer? That's something we're actually going to be seeing a lot of too. Now, she's going away. Sorry, we're going to be seeing hopefully a lot of warthog piglets soon, which means easy snacks for the leopards and the lions. Sorry, that was me whistling. I just wanted to let Andrew know that she was about to walk right behind his vehicle while he was trying to reverse through some bushes. And off she goes. Now she's going to go down into a very difficult spot here. But hopefully it'll be easier now with Andrew being around that we can play leapfrog and he can help us try and keep up with her. Because it's going to get very difficult. So let's go around. Let's go up a bit further on the road. I wish I could read animals' minds though, because I'd love to know what's actually going on in her head. Let's see if we can get one more view of her. It just depends where she's going to disappear down into. Also just check, I think Andrew, I can see her. She is going along the drainage. Let's try and get up a little bit ahead. But I think I'm going to have to do some serious bundu bashing. So while I do that, let's go back to Jamie and see how she's doing.
Well done to Taylor for keeping up with the Queen Karula. She can be tricky at times. Well, we're back on Djuma once again, and of course, Herbert has been successful in his tracking endeavors, and I am on my way to just turn down my game drive comms. I am on my way to go and see what he's managed to locate for us. I've given up on our leopards for now. I have a sneaky suspicion that they've gone into Simbombili, having checked pretty much everywhere around Red Dam. That's the only remaining available option as to where they went. So I think they've gone into Simbombili. And I've abandoned the search for now, and we're going to go and see if we can find the lions that Herbert has managed to track down. I was just checking, because I've just knocked my indicator light. I was just checking to see whether it works. It doesn't. Fortunately, we don't need to do much in the way of indicating in the bush. Your chances of encountering a vehicle and having to show them where you're going are relatively limited. Apparently, these lions are back towards their usual spot on Gari Cutline. I'm making my way slowly. I'm not rushing in any direction. Well, I'm not rushing in that direction. We'll see what we can spot along the way. It's amazing how successful Herbert is in terms of tracking anything, but especially those lions. Unbelievably dedicated. And I think you'll all hopefully join me in wishing Herbert a very good luck for the important exam that he's got coming up soon. He's writing an exam. I think it's on the it's either the 22nd or the 23rd. I think it's the 22nd that he's writing his exam on Fugazi level 2, which is one of the guiding criteria. You get different levels of Fugazi, and you can only write a certain exam after a certain period of time spent guiding full time. And it's an incredibly stressful exam, and he's been working. It's unbelievable. He still manages to walk, he tracks, and at the same time spends a huge amount of time studying. I'm really wishing him all the best, and I think you'll all join me in that. And if you can, then send through your good luck wishes, then I will pass those on to Herbert. We're all keeping our fingers crossed for him. Very, very good.